Here. Pat Hubbard?
Here.
Pat Jacobs?
Here.
Dr. Sophia?
Here.
Derek Marshall? Not here. Ms. Mendelson?
Here.
Jack Newman?
Here.
Erin O'Donnell?
Here.
Dr. O'Donnell? Jane Foreman?
Here.
Dr. Smith? Absent. Angela Spencer? Absent. And Kim James?
Okay. We have a forum. Pledge of allegiance.
Anybody who might have an electronic device, cell phone, or anything of that nature, please turn it off.
Okay. We have two sets of minutes to adopt. The minutes of January 15, 2015, and the minutes of February 19, 2015. So on the first set of minutes, do we have a motion to accept these minutes?
So moved.
Second. Discussion?
Yeah. I just happened to notice again. A little piece of probably unimportant point, but the SPCA keeps being referred to as the ASPCA. I'll just open it like that and don't repeat that mistake again.
Okay. So all in favor of the January 15th? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Okay. So that's carried. The adoption of the February 15th, 2015 minutes. Do we have a motion to accept those?
Yes. So moved.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? No discussion?
Just the same.
Same thing?
Same thing, but I assume that I know.
And don't do that, can you? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
That was a temper.
You can say.
Did he say? Did he make it?
No.
But a simple no would do.
I'm sorry, Nathan.
All right, so the next on the agenda is the animal welfare and dangerous animal cases for the month of February and recent polls snapshot. Nancy, I know that your case is not in here. I was looking for the number.
We will just address it later on.
Okay. So any discussion on the animal welfare cases?
First, I'd love to say, just amazing I find it that people do not realize that you have to vaccinate or licensure their animals. It's just and disbelief in that when you have a sick animal, you obviously are supposed to get vet care. People don't seem to understand that. That's my commentary on it. Case number four.
Can you,
welfare case four.
At the bottom, we asked.
Page 37.
37. Now, all the, this entire document is numbered now.
Right. Very great. Thank you. In here, this is a question from Mr. James or Ms. Barney. It does say that. This individual who, I'm assuming these are recreation recreational medications or substances. It says here, 20 minutes after you get called, he wasn't going to get his dog back. You saw him walking through the dog adoption kennels at PAC, and also the officer actually told him that he would not be getting an animal adopted. How do they check this? I mean, I know there's a list or something, but exactly what is the procedure? Because we all know there's a do not adopt list from this. What, when they get to the adoption window, or what? How? What's the procedure that it has? It's checked, and how does somebody inform somebody they're on the do not adopt list? Obviously, I would think that they would know they're not on the do not adopt list, but obviously we have some people who are not. So, could somebody please explain the procedure, the process, or something that this happens in?
Ms. Empey, Mr. Chair, I'll refer that to Kristen or anything.
Okay. We can all actually, for various reasons, each section can place somebody on the do not adopt list. It's a memo describing kind of what the reasoning for that refusal will be. Sometimes it's as severe as something like this, or worse. Other times it may be that they fail to provide proof of sterilization for a special needs adoption or proof of medical care for an SMA. And at which time the licensing staff, the icon pops up when they check the ID, icon pops up and they would have that discussion at that point. And then in the more minimal cases, we may have, in order to be able to adopt, you need to do X, Y, and Z. Provide proof of documentation of the alteration on that report.
Okay, now this is going to kind of be off kilter here. Supposing somebody is a roommate or something at a certain address, and they come in to adopt because their roommate cannot do that, does it also flag the address or just the name?
At this point it does flag the name. Okay. And I don't know if community has the capabilities to flag under that address.
Okay. Thank you.
There have been times this year where with certain situations where you have to actually search activity reports. So if they don't feel right, we can search additionally to find out. And there have been situations that's resulted in denial.
Oh, very good. Thank you very much.
Case 9 on page 52 and 53. It says there were no animals impounded, but this person who was cited for their licensing and their rabies and neglect and tie-out wanted the officer to take his one dog, Lucky, back in order to turn the dog in. And the officer said it was a pickup fee, but he could drop the dog off himself at PAC, and the guy wanted the dog euthanized. And then he said, well, never mind, I'll just take the dog to Mexico and shoot him. I don't understand why the officer at that point just didn't take the dog.
Yeah.
And he was getting citations for neglect and tie-ups. So I don't understand why the dog wasn't impounded rather than let the guy take the dog to Mexico and shoot him in Mexico.
Mm-hmm. I had the same question.
Yeah, I had the same question.
Chair, members of the committee, again, officer, unfortunate staff. Supervisor 10 cases here, and I must address that and work for the research if no response is the right time.
I can not hear you.
You're off.
Speak up, I'm sorry.
Okay.
The welfare case number 9, 15-16-09-9. Question is, why wasn't Doug Pound the one that the owner threatened to take the dog and make him shoot?
This was an officer's judgment call at that point in time. I believe it was also an officer that was in training at the time, which she should have been made aware of that. We can always pick up a dog. They can call the supervisor. We'll waive the fee to get the dog out of a situation.
So I'm just assuming that it's their judgment, but it wasn't necessarily the best judgment at the time. I mean,
correct.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Is there ever a pickup fee when you're already there? I mean, the officer was already there looking right at the dog. Would there, aside from being able to waive the fee, wouldn't be any fee, would there, if you're already there?
Ms. Shereen, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, and if I might, I'll just say again, the officer, young, I don't know if they're a young officer or not, but they're a new officer. And again, more training may need to be taken when we talk about that versus when we don't. And apply that fee to an owner that just wants us to take an animal. There's no basis for us to do that. In this case, I'm not saying there wasn't basis. I'm not saying that in this case. But again, more education may need to be required of this officer.
May I guess?
Dr.
How long had this officer been on the job? I assume that she would have had some training before she was allowed to go out on her own, right? That's a question.
Obviously, the question. I shouldn't ask you if you're doing the order, but Dr. Kuzniacki, Mr. Chairman of the committee. Officer 10K, or Supervisor 10K, can you answer that question?
This officer has only been in the field on their own for approximately a month. I have also been out for a month when I had surgery on my hand.
Okay.
So, I did try to review some of these welfares, but unfortunately, they still can. We can still advise them of what their job is and what their capability of picking up a dog that we feel would be in danger at any point in time. We can always. There isn't one supervisor that will not waive the pickup fees for an animal that needs to be picked up.
So let me ask another question, please. Before they're allowed to go out on their own, how long are they out in the field with a more senior?
These officers were out in the field approximately, I believe it was at least 8 to 10 weeks of training in the field. They also did ride-alongs prior to that, basically shadowing senior officers. And of course, they also did their training on PowerPoint for different things. And yeah, say this was a judgment call that this person made. Yes, it is a procedure that we would normally do, but there also is another procedure to have that fee waived, based upon the circumstances that are involved.
Well, but the question isn't about a fee, because the officer, obviously, since they were there on a call, would have been able to pick that dog up without there being a fee.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if they're out there investigating and feel that the dog is being threatened in some way, or not being taken care of, they would pick it up and not charge a fee anyway, right? Am I right or not?
Normally, there are fees that are normally when they if somebody wants a dog picked up, there normally are fees involved, but we can, like I say, waive those fees at any point in time.
So maybe I missed something then. Was this somebody calling to have a dog picked up?
No.
Okay. So there should have not been a fee, period. I would think. They didn't call.
picked up.
No, but it was because the dog was owned by somebody, she felt that, you know, there was a pickup fee that would have been involved with it if he was turning the dog over for adoption or euthanasia. Normally there is a pickup fee, but it, like I say, we will always choose to utilize our best option, and that would be to get permission to waive that fee.
Well, I understand that new people, and even people that have been involved for a long time can occasionally make mistakes. But as long as they're made aware of what should be done, that's why I'm asking all these questions, is to find out just exactly what the background as far as training and amount of time and how do you deal with this.
Dr. Smith.
Reading the report, it seems pretty clear to me that the owner verbally told this Detective Pinte that he was going to take the dog to Mexico and have him killed. I mean, to me, that's a threat to the dog's life. That dog should have been impounded, whether it's being impounded for neglect or impounded for the dog's safety. We do that if dogs aren't being fed and taken care of. This dog was being verbally threatened. I mean, that to me, that's not a judgment call. The person verbally threatened to take the dog to Mexico and have him put down on his ranch.
And
this was a dog he originally wanted Officer Hinton to take away. Mm-hmm. So it's not a pickup. The dog was easily, could have been impounded for neglect and then for abuse.
Mm-hmm.
He threatened the dog. So I don't think it's really a judgment.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is in the report. We're not making this up.
No, and obviously the officer themselves, being new to the field, you know, could have actually, if she was confused, she could have called and asked either a supervisor or a more senior officer as to what to do in this case, and that was not done.
Ms. Hampton.
When this case was reviewed, somebody sent an officer out to see if the poodle was there or could have been taken down to Mexico.
No, I don't believe it was reset. I believe it said this case
does
was
say,
called.
It does say your recheck is pending, and we'll follow up on it.
Was that the recheck pending on that one?
I just have one question.
Oh, the recheck was done. The recheck was done on March 10th, not on tie-out, had shade, shelter, and water.
Where's the poodle? Well, only one dog.
It only says one dog, because it doesn't say which dog.
So now we've kind of compounded the issue. The more we hear, the worse it gets. So there's that issue, which now has gotten worse. And then there's the issue. I have a question on that. Just on the decision when it's made, is it made by the individual officer while they're out there, or do they have to call in and ask and get your permission to waive the fee?
Typically, they would call in and ask us from in the field when they're out in the field. They would call in and do that. A lot of some of the senior officers may make that decision immediately, pick up the dog, call us up and say, look, I picked up this dog, and we waive fees at this point in time. Because we will never refuse, you know, not to waive those fees.
So why wouldn't we?
Since we know we're
never going to refuse to waive those fees, and particularly in this case where they threaten the dog, why is that even an event where we need to have a decision made or reviewed by a supervisor when that officer, like you said, has that ability to make that call?
Shouldn't
we just take that out of the management structure where it becomes their ability to make that decision being out there?
Yes,
just,
we can.
Yes,
we can.
But anyway, because now we don't know where this dog is,
well,
we find out.
We can set this for a recheck and find out what exactly has occurred with the poodle and see where it has gone to at this point.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to follow up on that, and we will look at the change in the policy and as well the recheck.
Thank you. Any other, Ms. Hampton?
Can you put on the agenda for next month, please?
Yes, it can. Can this follow up be placed on the agenda, Michelle? Thank you. Any other discussion on these dangerous dogs or the welfare? No? Okay. Number one. We'll have the first call to the audience. Anybody that wishes to speak, please complete the document that's up front. Are there any individuals that want to address? You can even have the staff.
Okay, not in this time. There'll be another one later. All right, so the management report is next.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, first of all, I'd like to bring your attention to you had three documents on the table at your position when you arrived. The first is an amended agenda indicating that item 7, the first bullet in item 7, that was part of the agenda that was amended, the first bullet in item 7. We'll talk about that in a minute. It was changed to include reference to the ordinance. It was also included in the handout to you today that added a $1 per year for 5 years dog license fee increase to the proposed ordinance that we'll be discussing later today. That ordinance replaces, that three-page ordinance replaces pages 86 and 87 in your packet. I just want to point that out. It's not numbered 86 and 87. First of all, it has three pages, so they're numbered 86, 87, and 87A. Mm-hmm. But they replace pages 86 and 87, which is the previous version that went out with the packet. And then there was also the addendum included. Well, some of these things were emailed to you. I just want to make sure you have hard copies of that for those reading. Additionally, the chair members were provided an update dated March 13th of a memo from Ms. Barney to Deputy County Administrator Lesher in relation to an operations update that referred to many of the 22 items documents that the committee had on the agenda in past months. So I just want to include there is a written report on those issues for your consideration at your convenience. And the only other item I want to point out is page 82, the February operation report. We're on course. It's kind of leveled out here, plateaued out here, about 83% live release rate. And still having struggle keeping up with past year experience and enforcement responses and licensing operations. So with that, subject to your questions, that's the movement.
Yes, Ms. Hubbard.
I have an answer about 6.04.060, the pound fees. I see that it's crossed out that Pima Animal Care may waive any or all pound fees.
Mr. Chair, that will be an item, that is an item on the agenda for later, and we can talk to that. But the answer directly is, it was replaced down below in the next paragraph. So it is still in the proposal is keep in there. So if you look at the bottom of 6.04.0460.
So that is part of the new business.
Okay, and there's going to be, is this $35 for only released animals depending?
The ordinance itself is on the agenda for discussion, so it's item 7, first bullet. I was just referring to the fact that it changed from the version you had to the one I left you today. That's all that was an announcement about an agenda item, not an announcement item.
Thank you.
Sorry, I didn't mean to do it. My fault.
Would that be in the envelope you sent me?
Yep. Plus, I left a copy for you. Okay. Under number 6, old business, there's a number of items there. Some of that overlaps with just what we were talking about.
Mr. Chair, I'm sorry, Ms. Sweeney, if you're referring to the updated ordinance, it is not in the packet. That was sent out before we got this change made.
Oh.
But it was provided for you.
Ms. Amitage?
I'm assuming we're going to start with the county administrator's response to the committee's request for additional field officers.
Yes.
Okay, I would like to step in and show an example here of one prime example of this here of why we need more officers. This animal, I'm going to.
Well, first let's and I'll give you the time to do that. What I wanted to do is we received a response back for our request for the additional field officers, and so part of that was that the committee or the individuals that are representing the county are going to the different municipalities and asking them to pay for this, and it's in our packet, and but we haven't. And my question, part of that is to you, Mr. James, is this letter that went out to them. Indicating that we have requested an additional four items. We need four more officers. What has been their response, if any? Because Ms. Durkin of the Tucson City Manager, has she said anything? Because this was dated back on March 11th. I was wondering if she replied.
Mr. Newman, members of the committee, we have received responses from two of the city managers, office of Sarita and Marana. They requested to be placed on the next jurisdictional discussion they have with the county administrator, which is scheduled for April 14th. So we have received a request to join the project.
Now the jurisdictional discussion that you're having, is that part of the billing process that we're talking about, where wherein PAC is doing certain things and now they're being billed for it and they don't want to be paying for that? Is that part of that discussion?
Mr. Chairman of the committee, that is the part of the discussion.
The reason I bring that up is that there's a fair amount of documents back and forth between Mr. Huckleberry and a number of people related to that, and that's always what I'm asking.
Yes, it's still under discussion, that okay. Whole issue of services and agreements and funding.
That's the county obligation for animal care services.
Yes.
Ms. Emtage, since what you're talking about relates to that, you want to bring that up now, I guess?
Yes, I do. Okay. As we all know, we have been talking about how much we really need to have more officers out in the field. I have a case here the date on this is the 29th of November. They arrived in at this residence. Apparently, they must have been called by TPD because there was an officer there who stated that when he arrived, he found this animal bleeding from her feet and stated that there was blood all over. The owner allowed him to enter her yard and look at the dog, who was no longer bleeding, but did have some lumps on her teats. And she stated that the vet told her that the dog has cancer and just to keep very clean. And when I asked, this is the officer, when I asked when and what vet she went to, she stated that she took this dog, the owner said that she took the dog to Guadalupe Vet Clinic the prior month, and the vet tech at the front desk instructed her to keep it clean as she never saw the vet. She said that the officer said they did a premise inspection with a recheck date of 12-6. I was contacted about this because this owner was relinquished later, and I'll tell you how long later that this animal was relinquished, and the owner has requested the dog back. The owner cannot pay the fees, either the impound fees or the other associated fees or the vet care, and they contacted me to see if an organization would help take care of these, and I asked why there was such a big gap, because the next time this animal was checked on was the 28th of January, and I was told there was a shortage of field officers, and so they were not able to get back to the call. And at that time, when the officer arrived, nobody was home, gates were closed, no cars were in the drive, and they posted notice that they faxed proof that the animal had received veterinary care. Next date was the 21st of February. Two officers went out, and they went to check on the dog, and the owner was not at home, but they were able to contact her by phone, and she stated she took her dog to the Guadalupe Vet Clinic, but didn't have money to proceed with the vet's recommended treatment. She was informed she must take the dog to the vet and proceed with the recommended vet care within 24 hours, or bring the dog to PAC within 24 hours to receive or receive a neglect of vet care citations. On the 23rd, the dog was turned in,
Let's see, on the 23rd it says here, dog was turned down on the 22nd.
Of what month?
February. That she had complied with the recommendation, and they closed the case. Well, she stated that she was trying to get vet care for the dog and received a quote from Guadalupe for $195, and she was advised she needed to speak with the supervisor regarding the issue and that the dog would be called for 7 days. This owner, I mean, this was a very long time for this dog to be left without vet care. And this dog actually has a history with PAC. It's an American Bulldog, and it was first dispatched for neglect in 2011.
It was first dispatched?
PAC was first, there was an impound at that address in 2011. And
for this dog?
Let's see here. It says here, dog jumps the fence with rope around its neck, so it's been on tie-outs. The female boxer, or I'm assuming was the American Bulldog now, was underweight and needed vet care, and no vaccination, no license. And she was impounded 34 in 2011. So this was 2013. So she's been here before. This is not the first time. So this owner has had at least 3 instances where this dog has been checked on. And one, I'm disturbed it took that long to have the action taken where the owner did turn the animal in. That animal should have been taken into custody in November because there's a history. And I don't know when you go out on a case if you check to see if there are previous infractions regarding the animal in question or something at that address. And if that's the case, I really feel that the owner should not be given a chance if they have not vaccinated, if they're not licensed, and they have failed to provide that care because they cannot claim ignorance in the law. Because obviously they've had a couple of incidences here. But the timeline from November to February is unacceptable. And we need to really push forward because how many other cases are falling through the cracks because we don't have enough officers out in the field. So again, we need to implore the leaders of our community that they need to step up to the plate. They really do because an animal in pain can bite. This is just unacceptable.
Well, I think it begs the other issue that once again we had an officer there that had the ability to, whenever a dog is in pain, I guess here's when I'm going to ask my questions now. You have a dog, you go out, it's in pain, it was emaciated or whatever, and you can see that it is. Should that person be cited at that point for a neglect of that dog?
Depending upon the condition of the dog, once again, it's an officer's ability to assess that animal.
I'll give you the condition here. The dog is emaciated. It looks like it hasn't been fed for quite some time and has not been receiving water. You can see the ribs on the back of it. You can see that it clearly has not been taken care of. Those are the circumstances. So now you know that dog, they should be cited. Should that dog be left there with them after being cited?
The condition, based on that condition, the dog should be picked up, brought to the Pima Animal Care Center, mm-hmm. and assessed by our vet here. Those are animals that have been severely neglected. We wind up possibly issuing a bond, mm-hmm. holding the dog for bond if the owner does not relinquish ownership of the dog. This particular call has been reopened for the same exact officer to respond back to issue citations to that owner.
And on this case, I would like to recommend that since this woman seems to not have financial resources, if to find her weight by the court, that it be mandated that she not be allowed to have any animals. I don't know of very many vet techs that give out information at a vet clinic without seeing it, and that should have been a red flag for the officer.
Granted, I don't believe the owner had provided any proof in writing that the dog had ever been to the vet at that point. And that case has been reopened because of that.
Okay.
So in a situation like that, do we cite them for, it's like abuse of the dog? I mean, a dog is sitting there suffering, and it hasn't had any type of medication or anything like that, and then that person is there, they know it. Isn't that some sort of an abuse of an animal?
The thing is, I don't believe the officer, we have the ability with our computers, if they are in fact receiving a signal at that point for the for availability of chameleon, to search that address. And searching that address would have pulled up the 2013 call. Also searching that dog's animal ID in a kennel screen would have pulled up any subsequent impounds on that dog. And
I don't believe it was done. It wasn't done? But that's a normal course of action that should be done?
That is a procedure that should be followed each time.
Is that the same officer that we had here earlier that we were talking about? Or is that a different officer?
No, it's a different officer.
Different one. Are they new? Are they new as well?
That person is not new.
So we need some retraining here.
Yes.
So, okay. So if we go through each one of these, are we going to keep finding the same thing? That's what I'm kind of curious about.
We're in the process of starting to retrain and refreshing some of the older officers as to what needs to be, what needs to be really looked at. You know, looking at the situation and seeing a dog and saying, this is something that's occurred, maybe it's just a fresh cut or a fresh injury, something, but something that looks like it's been there for quite some time, it basically shows that this owner hasn't gone and sought medical care.
And then again, here when somebody says, well, I didn't talk to the vet, but the vet tech told me this, they don't do that.
All right. Thank you. All right, the next was the, this has been withdrawn. It's the PAC protocols for treatment of tick fever. Mr. Jacobs, that was, we, based upon your request, the individual was contacted and they're fine with the situation.
I understand that the citizen's happy, I'm happy.
The next one is the volunteer policy and partnership agreement PAC. Now that was a while back, I left it on the agenda, and the only reason I guess it's back, well, nothing goes off until it's finished. But I think that came up, and I asked a question about, there was an individual volunteer that was being brought in to talk about the way they're talking or communicating. But Andrew Stocker indicated the volunteer policy, which then got me curious as to, do we have a volunteer policy?
Mr. Chairman of the committee, I'll refer that question to Kristen. Okay.
Mr. Chairman of the committee, we do currently have a volunteer policy that everyone signs. All of our current volunteers have a policy that they sign, but you guys know that we've been in the process of revamping, and we took in the advice that we got, this was a couple of meetings ago now, and sort of retooled all of it. And I would like to, since we are just having it reviewed now, be able to present that to you at the next meeting, if that's agreeable to everyone, and you have that in your packet ahead of time so you can review it.
Thank you. Okay. Castaway Treasures Animal Sanctuary, that's still on the agenda. I believe you wanted to ask a question about that. Of course, that I have a question about that as well, but it kind of has to do with what I just talked about, so I'll wait till you say what you want to say about that.
I saw Castaway's Treasures yesterday. So my information is only 24 hours old. And I just drove by. I didn't have a tour of the place. I was not able to see the dogs very carefully, very, very closely, but I did see some of the horses because they are right next to the road. I saw them without even getting out of the car, and some people I was with took videos I'd like to show you the videos, and it's a little hard to deal with videos, but I'd like to show them to you anyway. Several of the horses were emaciated, and one of them is has to stand on three legs. It's constantly putting its left front leg way out like this. It can't stand. It can't stand on that left front leg, and it's constantly moving it out way up like this. And I have a video of it. This friend of mine. It takes a while to get it focused for each one, but. Would you like to see? You have to wait until it's going until it lifts its lifts that leg way up.
I don't want to hold up. I mean, I believe it. I suppose we should pass it around to the other people.
You're so
they can take a look at it.
Lydia, will you go around and wait until it lifts up, and if you help them call it up, you can look at it together. And when they lift that, a constantly lifting a front leg way up like that, it's a sign that they are in great pain. And this horse has been like that for several months, with nothing whatsoever being done to help it.
Is this the same horse we heard of?
It just keeps doing that.
That's not the same horse that Jane,
Jessica
for her. That's not the same horse.
It might be.
So this is not the same horse that was dying?
No.
This is another horse.
It's a different horse. There are lots of horses suffering out there. Are you waiting there to...
No, we're seeing it. We're seeing the leg. Yes.
And somebody else was out there with me on the videos. Somebody else took videos also on the same thing.
Dr. Smith.
I'm going to interrupt you for a second. I know Kristen sent a letter to Sharon Bronson in response to her letter. Has anything happened since you sent that letter that was dated March 10th? Have you been down to the dog yet? Have you been out there? What?
No.
I'm sorry.
I wasn't
through. I'll let you finish. I want to know what her letter.
Oh.
If they. If what has happened. And then I'll let you go.
Sorry.
Okay.
And this letter went to the Board of Supervisors yesterday.
From Pat?
Yes, from someone through, actually from Dr. Garcia's office.
Okay.
So you see, I haven't had a chance. I mean, I don't get these. I don't know what the sheriff's office claims to have done, or they claim that there's no point, that there's no need for doing anything. But I know for a fact that there is. I saw these animals suffering, and I saw it with my own eyes. Now, I have this it's a memo that Mr. James gave me, and it says here, though PAC does not routinely respond to livestock complaints and defers to the Livestock Division of the State Department of Agriculture, PAC does cooperate with investigations and, at the request of the Department of Agriculture, will at times make assessments and report back to the Livestock Division. The state has not requested such assistance in this case. Well, I believe that PAC could volunteer this without waiting to be asked. I think you should just go ahead and make make an assessment and not just make it on the limit, on the linear axis. But there's an assessment that really needs, it desperately needs to be made about this, about many of the animals. I saw several that were emaciated, but this one in particular was showing signs of pain when they lift their front leg up like that, way up in the air. It is a sign of pain, and it's been in pain for quite a few months. And so nothing has been done. And what could and should be done is that this horse should be moved immediately to Jessica's rescue ranch, the Wild Hearts Rescue Ranch, where she has three veterinarians waiting to help her. And this horse is, she gave me some information on what could be done to help the horse. And then again, she said that it's probably got an abscess. That's one cause, and she knew what the other cause was. That leg up, that the horse should be put on dry sand, and that it'll never heal standing in wet manure, but it needs to be placed on dry sand, and veterinarians need to do whatever they do to an abscess. And she wasn't sure that even it could be treated. She thinks possibly this might be a sad case of where it would be more humane to euthanize this horse, but once it got to her rescue ranch, it would be assessed by three veterinarians, all of them horse special, large animal equine specialists who are standing ready to help her. And so, one thing I would like this group to ask PAC, to ask the Sheriff's Department to do something that they have never done so far and done at all, and that's move this horse, and this is just be a small part of what Castaways needs, but it would at least be helping this one horse to have it moved immediately to Wild Hearts Rescue Ranch, where it would get veterinary care from three different veterinarians, or euthanasia if that's the only best thing for it.
So let me understand. You're asking this committee to make a recommendation to PAC to make an assessment on the horse.
Well, not just an assessment, but that this particular horse, which I have shown you videos of it lifting its leg, left leg constantly, which is a sign of pain.
Right.
I mean, that's good enough assessment. This horse should just be moved. And this is just a small part of what needs to be done with Castaway Treasure, but this particular horse needs to be moved immediately to Jessica's rescue ranch.
Okay,
I have two comments. One is that, yes, I agree with you, the horse is obviously in some kind of pain. We don't know why and what is causing it, except that it's in the front leg. A horse that cannot keep its front leg on, you know, on the ground for any length of time is obviously suffering. Yes, I think that the horse, if it's been doing it for any length of time and hasn't had any care or assessment of the problem, should probably be moved and gotten some veterinary care. Whether it should be done at the rescue facility or not, you know, that might, I mean, there are probably other places it can be taken. This might be and I'm not saying it is, and I'm not saying that it should or should not, but it's something that should be taken into consideration. These people are at each other all the time, and there may be more going on there than you think, and perhaps another more neutral place might be better. But it definitely should be taken care of, and I don't think that just letting it sit there is good for the horse or anybody else.
Yes.
Well, I mean, I'd be willing to take it. I've got room. I've got, you know. But again, I'd be in a position where it might not look good either. Okay. Being part of this committee.
Not good.
Well, because. Because it should be someplace neutral, okay?
Well, there isn't any, nobody.
I could probably find somebody neutral.
But anybody who's an expert on horses are not neutral. I mean, this has to be someplace that and I happen to be, Jessica works with me as a volunteer for People for Animals, and I know that her rescue place is very good.
You know, and I may agree with you, but I'm just stating what I think, and I.
But the point is, how do you get the horse from these people? I mean, we already went through that with the other horse that was actually suffering. So, and PAC has made, and I'm not sure unless things change, you guys have said that you're not going to deal with the horses, right?
Mr. Chair, members of the committee. That is correct, that livestock is a state responsibility, and as you will discuss later, and you've already talked about the shortage of staffing, and we're now in a hiring freeze in the county, and for many other reasons, we got plenty of cases that dogs and cats are not even getting to, that we need to get, step up our, redouble our doubled efforts on. A couple of points, if I may, Mr. Chair. If we could have a copy of that video, if you could send that to me, along with this tape, I will send that to both the Sheriff's Department and the State Agriculture Department for their consideration as they either finish up or look further into this case, into this particular property. Additionally, if I might make a recommendation, the committee may want to consider drafting or preparing and sending a letter to the State Agriculture Department and the governor of the state saying we're not happy with the way that livestock is, welfare responsible as livestock is in Southern Arizona. And that's a livestock responsibility. And the fact that they sent a letter out to Southern Arizona saying, oh, we can't hire anybody, so you guys take care of yourself. We've already got enough state mandated things we have to pay for. And the state, out there, I'm going to be careful, that's all I'm going to say. But anyway.
No, well, I was headed in that direction as far as what can we do in concert with PAC, because PAC can make recommendations. I mean, they can't necessarily want to bring a horse here, but they can, based upon the video, and so can we, make recommendations and send whatever documents we need to send. So I agree with you as far as that goes.
Jessica has the ability to pick up the horse and other horses too.
Yeah, but we don't have the authority to order it.
No, we can't order it, but the sheriff could order it, and it could be done immediately.
But how do we get the sheriff to do that then? I mean, we're talking about right now. We are talking about ways of trying to engage the sheriff's department or engage the livestock department to actually do that. Right? Isn't that what we're trying to do?
Yes, that's right.
So I mean, we know they can do it, but they're not doing it. So
they ordered that it be done, which they should have done 2 or 3 months ago, and the horse has been standing right there this whole time without anything being done to help it at all. Mr. James, representing PAC, could communicate with the sheriffs and say that this group has asked him to communicate our opinion that this horse should be rescued immediately and taken to Wild Hearts Rescue Ranch. Though I do appreciate, I mean, I'm sure I would love your place also.
Well, I have room, and if you guys want to do it, I have been a horse veterinarian also, although I don't do anything with my own horses now, but I do have another vet that works for me that is an equine practitioner.
But Jessica is the one who has...
Well, and I understand that I'm not saying, you know, one way or the other. I just think that, you know, I happened to just mention that just because it came out of my mouth, all right? But I, you know, one of the other things that I would like to see, just as a suggestion, is that the video isn't the best in the world. I believe what I see on it, and I believe you, okay? But if it would be possible to take video that is more close up, with a, you know, a telescopic lens or something that it could be more close up, where people could see it better, that might be involved, and that would, you know, because I don't think that many people right now could look at that video and you see what you see because you saw it with your own eyes.
Yes.
Okay. But it is far away, and there's fencing in the way, and things like this, and the average person might not catch it. Okay. So if you want anybody to really look at that video, I would suggest you get a better video camera and take some pictures. But
well, we did have a third person with us who took videos too, but yeah. She's not.
I just emailed her and told her to email Mr. James.
Mr. James, would it be best for us to write something with you, or in that way you could have that as a document? Or,
Mr. Chair,
what would be the best way to do that, to give you the most influence that you could have when you make that discussion?
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, as to refer to the Sheriff's Department, that video and the tape of this discussion, I think is sufficient. I'll refer that all to them and make sure they have that as soon as possible upon my return Monday.
I would suggest that on the video, normally when you do something like a video and you use it in a legal way somewhat like this, that you make a declaration that this video was taken by you on this date, and then you sign it. So that way that video has documentation behind it as to what the video was, when it was taken, and
where
who took it, and where it was
where?
Taken.
Well, I just don't want to cause so much of a delay, because even if I didn't have a video, I'm telling you, I saw this with my own eyes yesterday. And this lady also saw it, and there were three of us who saw it.
I'm sorry.
I mean, just our testimony, our word alone ought to be sufficient.
Well, it is. It's just that right now you submitted a video,
yeah,
which is good to have.
Yes.
And so we want to validate that video. And I think we're all trying to do everything that you want, I mean, because we want the same thing, but I don't think anybody here is going to jump up and go get that horse right now, tonight. So I think we're doing the best I think we can do.
Chair, members of the committee, I know I said Monday, you don't have to wait for me. If you'll get it to me and or Kristen, her staff can forward that to the Sheriff's Department immediately. As well as Michelle can possibly get a copy of this tape and send that for that. We'll certainly send the video immediately along with the list that Ms. Shireen is a point of contact as a witness to this. They can affirm all of that at a later point and add that to their case as soon as we get the video tonight, the first thing tomorrow.
Mr. Jacobs.
And if I might,
but
also to maybe even copy the video along with a letter from the committee to the state of Arizona, the governor and or the director of the Department of Agriculture, indicating we're not happy yet.
Can I get with you and we can draft up a letter?
Yes.
Or she's very good at drafting letters.
I move that we take Mr. Jane's suggestion and draft a letter to the governor and to the Department of Agriculture and send a letter with the video. I don't know how we can send a letter, a hard copy and a video, but we can post it on YouTube. I mean, and we can make some phone calls. I mean, you can make a phone call and that'll happen today, but a letter's not going to get out until tomorrow or Monday. Nothing's going to happen overnight unless you go and pick up the horse yourself, and that's not going to happen. But we can make phone calls. You could post that on YouTube.
Mr. Jacobs?
I have a number of questions. It starts first with the report which we just received has a sentence that says, Mrs. Bruno was cooperative and allowed the officer full access to the property and to the animals. I'm just reading the report. Seems like she's not this uncooperative and maybe cooperative. Secondly, do we not have a working relationship between our enforcement and the sheriff where we could simply call, you know, the head of our enforcement, call the head, you know, the sheriff's contact and say, can we go out there? I have this video. We need to go out there tomorrow. Number three, if the good doctor has an equine veterinarian, she's willing to donate his or her time, maybe they could take the veterinarian with them and settle the issue then and there tomorrow. End of report.
At some point, they would not allow even one of the veterinarians who was a member of the Animal Cruelty Task Force, they wouldn't even allow her to go onto the property.
Well, she's not as cooperative as it says
that's
here.
Right, that's right.
She's cooperative with you, with you and the dogs, but not with the horses. But that could be in the letter we're talking about. She's not cooperative when it comes to the horses.
Is that the case?
She's been cooperative with the horses. They were required to get vet care for 5 horses.
I'm trying to avoid what I am feeling, and that's just a feeling, that there's some kind of interaction between the lady who made the report last week and the people who have the horse. And I'm just trying to overcome that and get to the horse. That's what we should focus on. Thank you.
Let me ask you, where it says Ms. Bruno provided information on the treating veterinarian, did they?
Dr. Sarah Brooks.
And has anybody contacted her to find out?
We have not. They're working directly with Ron Hirsch, which is the livestock officer, and Detective Treehan from the Pima County Sheriff's Department.
Well, I mean, I would be interested whether she just gave a name or
we could contact Dr. Brooks.
Or whatever, you know. Yes, no.
Well, just is Jessica? It was first reported to Jessica. Jessica reported this one time back in August, and then again in January. So it's not as if she's been harassing the people, but she's very much concerned because she lives her life to help horses, and she, before this castaway treasures thing came up, she was running a very nice horse rescue, which I help her with, and she's also a member. She also works with as a volunteer for People for Animals.
We don't doubt her. What we're trying to do right now is, even though Pat, you know, can't bring a horse in here, we're just trying to work out the mechanics of taking care of what you're talking about.
Well, the mechanics are that she could go get that horse.
No, she can't.
She can't. She has no right to seize it.
She's not allowed. I didn't say legality. He said mechanics.
Well, yeah. That's what I mean. Justice. Legal mechanics of it, right? To do it legally.
Well, you were saying something about bringing the horse here, and I tried to make that clear a month ago. I'm not asking that the horse be brought here. The horse would not be brought here, of course. Mm-hmm. But that Jessica does have the equipment to pick up the horse and transport it.
Mr. Jacobs.
All I'm asking is, as we develop the letter that will go to the state, so that we become, you know, we can solve the problem by asking our staff to ask the sheriff to work with them and to have a neutral veterinarian involved. Let's solve the problem first, and then we can address the policy regarding livestock review versus, you know, the state versus local. If we can do that, it doesn't slow down the process of you writing a letter.
Correct.
Thank you.
Yes, that's what we're going to do.
I hope all of you know that the chairman of the Pima County Board of Supervisors and the Pima vice chairman of the Pima County Board of Supervisors have already written a letter. And, huh? It was in our packet, yes. And this lady, Gail Smith, has already written a letter, and the mayor has already written a letter. So we can't get put too much faith just in a letter from us, but from some pack that had a market. And I haven't seen the mayor's letter. Do you have it?
Shereen, Mr. Chair, I do not, but I feel a letter from this committee adding to what the Board of Supervisors has done will make a difference. Maybe not the difference that we all like, but every effort will help. And you still have a motion on the table, but no second, if I may.
I'll second.
Okay, all in favor of drafting a letter that addresses what we just spoke of? Aye. Say aye.
Aye.
This is Gina Means. I didn't hear anybody. Anybody? All opposed?
Opposed.
You're opposed to writing a letter?
If we're not going to do anything else but write a letter, that to me is, you know.
Okay. All right. You guys opposed. All right. So I'll get with you. Yeah. Well, you will get to the talk because. Okay. All right. Good. Next on the agenda, ways to shorten.
Could anybody tell me what was done about the some veterinarian ordered that 5 horses to be treated? See, I'm not able to get sheriff's records or what happened there.
Ms. Shereen, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I have not seen any further report from the sheriff's department that I released anything at this point, so they would be the ones that you have to ask that question.
Well, I know it didn't do this horse any good. I saw it with my own eyes, and I don't care what anybody says.
The same touch.
I heard something at one of the dogs was ordered to be euthanized or something. What was that?
Angie was euthanized on February 9th.
Can we ask why?
Yes, we can.
The dog was 14 years old and had a lot of health issues. She was also emaciated. They did seek veterinary treatment from, I believe it was Dr. Augustine, and he did some recommendations up to and including euthanasia, and it was documented the dog was euthanized, and Detective Crean from the Sheriff's Department did verify that.
Who provided the veterinary?
Dr. Augustine.
Who provided him? Who paid for him? Let's put it that way.
Cashless treasures.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well, that leads me to what I was thinking about before. When we went out, when PAC went out and they saw that dog that was emaciated, that particular dog, then they were given what kind of document to take care of that dog?
They were given a premise inspection, and I believe they were out there on, it was in January, and the recheck was February 3rd. They went back out on February 3rd, which was only maybe 4 or 5 days later, and they were told at that time that Dr. Augustine was coming on the 9th, which would have been that, you know, 6 days later, and that the dog was going to be euthanized, and in fact, that dog was euthanized.
Okay, so from the period, that's about a 2 to 3 week period of time, if we're looking at
January.
January what?
It was the end of January. I'm not sure if it was January 28th or the 31st. It was in that time period.
23rd?
28th or the 31st. I'm not exactly sure what date they originally, it was
they go out there and they see your officer sees that the dog is emaciated, and they say this dog needs a vet because it's in bad shape. Why wouldn't we cite them at that point now that we've seen that dog emaciated? Whether it be 3 years old or 15, why wouldn't we cite them at that time with a citation saying you have allowed this dog to look like this?
He checked the food that the dog was being provided. I believe it was after the 2 days, the two straight days of rain that we had, where we had torrential downpours in January. This was the only dog that was found to be thin out of all of the other dogs, and they didn't have any, he wanted documentation as to if this dog had a medical condition that was causing the dog to be emaciated.
Was there a medical
condition? Dr. Augustine did actually come here personally and drop off a handwritten diagnosis, and his diagnosis basically outlined his exam of the dog and his recommendations up to and including euthanasia, which is what was.
And did he say that the dog was had some sort of illness, and that's
yes, why it wasn't he, I believe it was diabetic was one of the things on there. There were other issues and up to and including the age of the dog.
Okay, so let's say that everything was done correctly with that dog. But let's say now that there was no, other than they weren't feeding the dog, would we have given the citation retroactively because we know now that the dog hadn't been eating because they weren't feeding it or something like that?
Based upon, yes, non-nutritional food or no food, you know, being denied food.
I see. Okay.
I have a question. Usually when we have this situation, somebody else would have been given 24 hours for vet care. They were not given 24 hours. They were given several days because they said that that was already scheduled to go out. They also have a history of having PAP at their facility. So why weren't they given a 24-hour time to get the animal vet care that some another member of the public would?
The officer assessed the situation itself and the dog's condition and didn't feel that the dog basically was in distress at that point. So he opted to give them a specific amount of time based upon the vet already being scheduled to be there. Their vet actually comes to their, does a house call.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Jacobs.
Would you entertain that motion?
Yes, sir.
I move that we ask our enforcement supervisor or designated person to see if the sheriff would allow us to accompany them with a neutral volunteer veterinarian to specifically see this horse, which we have information may be in distress.
Is there a second to that motion?
What was it? Was Linda giving you?
Basically, I'm just saying that we asked the enforcement folks to talk to the sheriff and say, will you accompany us with a neutral veterinarian to go out and see this horse post-haste, tomorrow, if possible, so we can see what's happening with this horse and have it treated if necessary.
We have a motion on the floor.
The committee. We're asking. The committee is asking the staff to do this.
If members of this committee can go out and look at.
No, that's not what he's saying.
It's not the committee. It's not the person next door who's complaining. It's our staff, our professional staff, asking the sheriff, who they have a working relationship with, I believe, to say, can we, you accompany us, and we if we can get a volunteer veterinarian, and I suggest you ask Dr. Sophia, to go out tomorrow and look at this horse and see if it needs treatment and to be treated. We need to do something about the horse. We can sit here and argue about why the state's not doing it or why who should take the horse away, but I'd like to get out and treat the horse myself.
Okay, that's the motion on the floor. Is there a second?
I just wanted to.
No, is there a second?
I'm abstaining.
You're abstaining?
Yes, okay. Because I.
Second going once.
Well, if I understand it, I think I would second it.
You're seconding it. Okay.
Sorry,
is there discussion?
Yeah, discussion.
Yes, Mr. James. Well, no, Mr. James.
And again, just a friendly note that I am aware that these horses are also under, are being looked at and have been looked at by veterinarians. So they're under a vet's care.
Any further discussion? Mr. James.
I think they couldn't possibly be under a vet's care. Or they're certainly not doing any good. This horse is in a lot of pain and has been for many months. And I want to repeat something that I said before. The horse cannot, Mr. Jacobs, the horse cannot very well be treated where it is because it's got this something wrong with the bottom of its foot.
That's not what Mr. Jacobs is saying. He's trying to do is
we're
see
diagnosing and we don't know
what is on the floor happen. Right now is whether as a committee we are going to vote on whether we're going to request of PAC to utilize their resources with the community within their enforcement to talk to the Pima County and see if we cannot get a impartial vet to look at this horse. That's what's on the table right now. So that's what we're going to vote on.
Well, we did.
No, but we're going to vote on that. All in favor?
That's
aye.
Not exactly what he said.
That's what he said. Is that what you said?
That's the intent of my motion.
Okay.
Can I just say something?
Sure.
He said, I thought he said to treat the horse.
No.
And he did mention the word treat.
I did, and I'm...
And I just wanted to remind you that the horse cannot be treated where it is.
Based on that, I removed that language from my motion.
Okay.
So what's the motion? Say it again.
The motion is that we, as a committee, ask PAC to see if they can accompany the sheriff with a neutral veterinarian to give us a report of what this animal is suffering. If there's another veterinarian involved, first of all, that's what it was. Can I discuss it? My experience is with veterinarians, if one veterinarian is going out and there's another veterinarian involved, the protocol usually is to communicate. Saying, I've been asked to do this, I understand that this animal's under your care, can I discuss it with you? Before I decide to go out or not go out or do whatever and do this. If there's a veterinarian who can give us a report, then I'm willing to accept the report. But I'm not willing to take on the state of Arizona based on just a video that I see for 2 minutes and we pass around the room.
Yes, Doctor.
Because the Brunos were ordered by someone to provide medical care for 5 horses, and those horses are supposedly under the care of Dr. Brooks, would we have the authority to request medical records on those horses from Dr. Brooks to review them to ensure that they are medically cared for? Would that not answer a few questions?
Dr. Ronald, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, as this is a Sheriff's Department case, we want to be very careful about asking for medical records for horses that they're currently under investigation. We can certainly ask the Sheriff's Department if they have any that they are at this point able to and willing to share. So we can certainly do that.
I suspect that they'd have to subpoena those records from the vet before the vet would voluntarily hand them over because of client privilege.
The motion that's on the table now, all in favor, say aye.
To
request PAC to talk to the Sheriff's Department and ask for an impartial vet to review the situation. All in favor?
Aye.
I abstain.
That's three.
Obvious reasons.
I guess I'm in favor of it. We're still going to write the letter?
Yes.
That passed. I understand.
Yeah, we're going to write the letter.
Okay, that's 4. 5. Okay, 5 ayes, 2 abstains.
I abstain.
You abstain?
I abstain.
Why are we abstaining?
Well, I'm not sure we have the authority to do it. I don't want to get in the middle of a pissing contest between Pima County and livestock.
Okay. But we're going to write a letter to them?
I'm not going to write a letter. Somebody is. Okay. I mean, writing a letter and asking somebody to do something is a lot different than saying, you're sending a vet, you're taking care of vet care, but now we're going to kind of step on your toes to see if you're really doing what we think you should do, rather than saying, hey, can you handle this issue? Which is a lot different in my mind.
Thank you. Okay. All right, so it's 5 yes, 3 abstain.
3 or 4 abstain.
1, 2, 3. And four. Okay, 4. Passes, 5-4.
5-0. 5-0.
Yeah, 5-0. Well, that's passed. Yeah.
5 yeses. No, no.
0. Okay.
4 abstentions.
All right. We're going to move on. Ways to shorten the hold time for confiscation of cases. I was just going to ask on that. This has been on here for so long. Can we have ask someone from the legal department to, excuse me? Can we ask someone from the legal department to maybe come here and explain what can be done to shorten the length? Because we've been talking about this, but no one's really ever come and said, well, we can do this to shorten the length of time. But I see someone twitching over there, so.
Well, I'd refer this to Kristen and the enforcement staff, but I do know that we've had reached out to talk to them about this very issue. Oh. And since December, have closed the loop with, I don't believe we've closed the loop with the attorneys that we want to talk to about those issues and how we at least minimize the number of times the judicial system and or the impact of that. So we've got to hold on to it for whatever reason, but we need to have that discussion. Hasn't had it yet, but I'll shut up now.
Mr. Chairman of the committee, I just wanted to add that this is an issue that we've started to do even a little bit more research on, so we can take that information to the sheriff, or to the sheriff. Too much discussion to the county attorney and say this is sort of what we're doing and what do we really need to move forward with these cases and what is the recommendation. So I know it's been on there for a while, but it's not anything that has dropped off of the radar. In fact, we've been gathering more information.
So we'll just leave it on until the answer. Okay, the new business. Now we're on the proposed ordinance to amend Pima County Code 6.04060, pound fees. To add a surrender fee for pets from non-contracted jurisdictions and increase dog license fees. I didn't actually place that on it, but that's being placed on here. So, Mr. James, the floor is yours on this.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, staff was asked to develop the ordinance that's been prepared and provided to you a little bit late, and we added a dog licensing provision to the original one. So you have the new one in front of you. In essence, the request has been, and the ordinance is intended to do a couple things. One is with the challenge that this. That all of our jurisdictions are facing with funding and how to fund all the things and how they continue doing services and what services have got and those types of things. And as you know, we're in discussion with jurisdictions about services we're providing, those that they feel like they can't afford and those they can't, that they may not pay. And I'm not saying that's a fact, but those are just some of the things that have been discussed. And that should the eventuality happen, that we have contracts with some of the jurisdictions and not with others. What do we do with animals that come in from jurisdictions that have chosen not to have an agreement with us? And as we know, that a very good model which is used to facilitate and assist in offsetting expenses associated with caring for animals in a shelter environment is the UNSI of Southern Arizona. They have a fee structure that they charge, they charge $35 to individuals that make an appointment and say, I'd like to bring this animal in. And then they make an appointment at any time that the managers for intake is one of the reasons that we thought it would be used. And I suspect that might be one of the reasons we made society Southern Arizona. I'm very nervous speaking about what they do or don't do because
That's here. She knows what they do.
I know what they do.
I'm sure you can talk to that and correct me where I'm wrong. And then for those that do not have an appointment, will walk in and say, here, I just can't have this, or I found this stuff, or whatever it is. There's a $70 fee attached for that turn in for that animal to be turned into the Humane Society of Southern Arizona. I'm not saying that we're the same. I'm not saying we have the same mission. I'm not saying any of that. All this is for animals that come from should it ever happen that we have jurisdictions that do not sign an agreement for us to provide services and to reimburse the county for the services provided for animals from their jurisdiction, this is a way to offset some of the expenses, a nominal amount of the expenses associated. We're going to care for those animals, so we still take them in.
Sure.
We will still continue to take animals in. I have full confidence, and for what that's worth, that the county will never turn anyone away. We'll just find a way to do it and take care of all these animals. But people will see that fee on there. They will say, I'm not going to go there. I got to find something else to do with it. And those something else's are less acceptable in many cases. If people come to our door, they'll call us, and we tell them these things. And they say, no, I'm not going to do that. Yeah, I found this dog in the city of Xanadu, for lack of a better term. And Xanadu doesn't have an agreement with us. So unless that's in a bad spot, to explain that and try to manage that. We're in great hopes that we will never have to use this ordinance, but we're asked to have it in to plan for and move down that path. And should it be adopted, be ready for that eventuality. So that if we have to support animals from jurisdictions that do not have a facility. And oh, by the way, Maricopa does this now. Very
yeah.
Similar thing. That's exactly how the Maricopa County Animal Shelter handles jurisdictions that don't have agreements with them. Not to mention some other high dogs. I mean, there's a little more than this, I think. But anyway, that's the first provision, and it has to do with adding that fee to the pound fee section, or 6.04060 of the center. All other things remain the same. And again, this would only apply to animals that come from a jurisdiction that does not have a current agreement with the Animal Care Center. We still have retained the right to waive fees in the best interest of the pets, and that will remain in the ordinance. And it remains in the same part of the ordinance that applies to this new fee structure as well. So again, we can, as necessary, waive fees, even if the person can't. Yes, we understand there's challenges with this. We're just in the infancy of looking and checking on this. As many of us, me included, picked up pets when we're out and about. Try to find its owner, we come in, scan this, no chip to it, we have no idea who it is, can't take it home to my house because my two dogs and sometimes my 10-year-old granddaughter and others, we don't want to put them at those kind of risks, so we have to leave it somewhere, and it comes in here. What do we do with those people? They're either from the city, they found something in that city, and they or that city or town, and then they turn it in, and we say, well, I can't take them, she gives $35. You walk in, $70. And that's just one of the many situations that might happen out there. We're very, very well aware of that challenge. But nonetheless, the option needs to be pursued at this time. The second item is 6.04070, our dog vaccinating and licensing provision. We were asked again with the tightening of the budget, and you have a memo from the county administrator that discusses some budget tightening steps that have been taken immediately and will impact us into the next fiscal year and beyond that. The county would like to pursue adding a $1 per year increase to the license fee for the next 5 fiscal years. So, for example, a $15 unaltered dog license fee, and this is only for unincorporated Pima County. City and towns have received this as well, so they know what they've been advised of where we're headed on this. I don't know if they'll follow suit or not, but this $1 per year for 5 years would mean that what was a $15 fee in 2015 will now be $20 in 2019, latter part of 2019. So,
What does that mean? That means $500,000 of revenue based upon 100,000 per 100,000 licenses that's provided to the shelter to offset the expenses and reduce the impact on the taxpayer. Assuming all else stays the same, we're dedicated to this course, continuing to run the shelter the way we run it, do the things we're doing, and save lives like we have. That is the intent of this proposal, is to provide the option and understand this edition of them.
Ms. Sabotage?
Okay.
Do you know
anything
else?
Okay.
I'm concerned because we saw a huge increase when the Humane Society started charging fees. A lot of people will just say, I'm opening up the gate, there it goes. That's what I'm afraid of if we've got these fees. The other thing is, frequently I get called and people need help and have litter puppies. And I tell them, you're not signing those puppies. You have to send proof that you have surrendered those puppies to a shelter so that they may be altered before they are adopted. They're going to be in here on a litter. If you relinquish a litter, and I know the Humane Society also has a fee for the litter relinquishment. And the other thing is people who the animals are accidental breedings, and they say, well, I've gone and I've gotten my mama dog spayed, but I got all these puppies. I don't want them handing out all these unaltered puppies. I would rather they bring them to the shelter where they are altered and they go to the spring home.
Yes, Mr. James.
Mr. Chair, I understood good points and all of that, the comments, and just I failed to mention that the process will be is this fee structure is also posted on the county website. It must be posted for 60 days before the county can change any fees or tax increase any fees, taxes, or make new ones. So it is posted there for the next 60 days for a comment period. So this is not the last opportunity for anyone to provide input. It will go to the Board of Health at their April meeting as well for them to consider and decide upon their position on this proposal, as well as citizens, individuals, agencies are encouraged to provide input directly to my office should they have any comments or all the concerns. And all those will be included in anything presented to the Board of Supervisors when I finally go before them on or after May 19th.
Okay, the other thing is, I pay property taxes, all right? This is a public facility, and the Humane Society is not, it's a private foundation. And so I'm concerned that the fact that we are a public facility, that we're saying to the public, no, we're not going to have these services available to you, that we're doing what a private company or foundation is doing. And that, you know, they just voted, the voters just said, yeah, we're going to sell bonds, we're going to do this to do $17 million in improvements in that.
22.
Or excuse me, $22 million. And 6 years ago, we had a new addition to the facility out of taxpayer money. So I'm concerned about this, because this is a public facility and it could come back to bite us.
Well, I'd like to respond to Nancy. First of all, it is a public facility. It has been a public facility for as long as it's been here. And we all can go back and see what a horrible place this has been over some of the years, because we don't have taxpayers getting money. Having a pet, owning a pet, is a responsibility. And if we're going to have people working for this center, or even in any law enforcement, trying to control the animals in this community, people need to, they need to ante up. I mean, I just feel that if you're going to have an animal, you have to be responsible. It's not a right to own an animal, it's a privilege. And I just totally disagree with the thought that people are going to turn away. I think at the end of this year, we're going to realize that the total intake between Pima Animal Care and the Humane Society of Southern Arizona has dropped quite a bit. And they're overcrowded at Pima Animal Care because they have committed to caring for sick animals. So yeah, they are crowded, but the numbers didn't jack up real high when the Humane Society put in the intake fee. It didn't at all, and it's all in the data. And it's been, you'll see at the end of this year that the numbers coming into this community, these community shelters, has decreased.
Okay.
I don't think people are going to say this is public public and I pay taxes, they should do it for free, because we pay taxes, we still have to pay for car licensing, we still have to pay for car registration, and that, and we pay for, you know, we pay gas tax and pay road tax. So I don't think people will say that, truthfully. And it's not a huge amount of money we're asking to take care of these dogs.
Okay, I'm going to say something. No. I think it's a bad idea, and I'll tell you why. The numbers have dropped for a lot of reasons, and I could go and delineate running the amount from 200,000 to 800,000 being spent on spaying and neutering and things like that. So there's a variety of reasons why it's gone down. But if you've been out, and I'm sure you have, been out to places like Dog Patch, and that's on the north part of town, where you have dogs that are just being dropped off willy-nilly, people just drop them off. On the south side of town, they're doing the same thing. These dogs are starving, they're sick, we wouldn't even have enough officers. It'd be great if we did to go out there and just clean those places up. I've spent time sitting out front here. We have one rescue organization that sits out here and tries to help divert animals to homes and things like that. But if you start having people, they won't drop the dogs off. They won't help the dog that's sitting in the street that's starving. They won't do that. And I've seen it. And so I understand the reason behind what Mr. Huckleberry is doing. I know there's a lot of political maneuvering going on because of what the city of Tucson is saying. We're not going to pay the price of taking care of these animals. And as a result, there's a certain amount of maneuvering going on as far as this goes. But I don't think the people of the city of Arizona, Tucson, Arizona, the city, the population of Tucson, Arizona, want this. I don't think that they're going to say, oh yeah, but we're going to spend $22 million on bonds and things like that, and then now we're going to be paying to drop dogs off. They just won't do it. So you're going to have a lot of animals suffering as a result of something like this. And I really think, and like you, and I can appreciate the amount of advocacy that you tried to do here, because you know you're an employee of Pima County and you have to present this. We've all been in that type of situation, but most of us know that this is not a good idea to try and charge people for bringing animals here. As it is, there are we're understaffed at PAC. We know we're understaffed at PAC. Volunteers come here and are making up the supplement, anywhere between 100 and 400 volunteers. And I would recommend to those volunteers, if PAC is going to all of a sudden now start charging and animals are going to start suffering out in this community, that we not show up. And then we'll see how PAC runs. Because PAC is here to take care of the animals of this county, not to start turning people away. The $25,000 to $40,000 to $60,000 every month coming in for donations are from people that want these animals, and that's not going to reduce the budget, by the way. That's going to help with the medications and things like that. That's what people are actually giving, that amount of money, $60,000 a month. Well, that's going off of your budget here, in fact. That's reducing the budget for that, not reducing it to help pay for more staffing, although that's on the table as well. So, from my perspective, I'm going to fight very hard to not have PAC or not have this type of ordinance put in. As far as raising the rates, I don't care about raising the rates a dollar. Things like, I don't think that's going to affect people very much. But I think you put a drop-off fee here, the four people you have working up front, you won't need them. You can put them in the back because people aren't going to be dropping that many dogs off. We've been here long enough to know that. And I'll jump on any soapbox again and keep talking as long as I have to for that. Okay,
I basically agree with everything you said, and I'm glad you mentioned, you know, the fact that there are donations. I do think that it's always a good idea when people drop off, and I hope they are being asked if they would like to donate anything to the shelter in order to help with the stuff. And that's an if they say, no, I can't afford it, fine. If they can afford, you know, and give you $5 or 10 or 15, that's fine too.
Mr. Jacobs and then Dr. Smith.
My concern is if a jurisdiction is added to decides not to contract with the county and does not provide the service to their community, and therefore that responsibility ends up with the county, what do we do? Do we simply say to Xanadu and, you know, you get a free ride?
No, well, it also goes this way. What do you do with the enforcement? Are you going to send trucks out into the city of Tucson if they choose not to have an agreement with us? So now all of a sudden Tucson becomes North Korea? We're not going to do anything? See? We know that this is just a very small part of the game that's being played. Because when someone calls for an enforcement officer, are we going to now say we're not going into Tucson? So it's a big thing going on. This is just a small part. But I think the people, the guys that are the people and men and women that are running Tucson are pretty bright themselves. They know he's putting this out there. We've all negotiated contracts before, and they're going to look at it for what it's worth. But this, so how's it going to pan out? I don't know.
The question was not how it's going to pan out, but do you think, can you think of any way where those jurisdictions will respond responsibly?
I don't know.
You don't know. That's fine.
Well, I don't know. That's a good answer. I wouldn't know yet. But Mr. James might have a better idea.
Mr. Jacobs, Mr. Chair, I don't know if I have a better idea, but I am aware of jurisdictions, even in the Maricopa County, they're in a very similar situation where they do not contract with the local animal carriers, do not have one themselves, and I've heard some of the stories of what happens there, and it's not something that I've ever heard anybody be comfortable with here in the county, the best I can answer and give you. We'd certainly have to do a lot of research, see how it's done, where, what's the best course of action, and that's all part and parcel of what the future would hold. Should that, which all that I've ever talked with, that's not in jurisdictional meetings and other ones. We want something that works and that we can that's affordable. How do we get there? That's the position from the other side, but we also need to find for the other side.
And when we're talking about reducing the budget by 2% here, everybody gets a 2% across the board cut. I look at that, first of all, PAC hasn't had much of a budget for the last 30 years, and so they shouldn't, in my opinion, should not be in the same boat as, let's say, other county agencies that have had consistently been reviewed and had their budget increased over the course of the last half century, from the 60s up till now. So now we take 2% off PAC's budget when PAC doesn't even have much of a budget. It should be. I think apportioned in the sense that we go with 0.2% to PAC, and let's say, for example, if the whichever has been budgeted properly, they would then get a 6% budget essentially because they have been receiving their budget rather than PAC not having much of a budget. So those are the different angles that I see it coming from. Ms. Minnison.
I have a question. I don't object to the dollar increase, so let me start with that, but I don't understand this whole thing. And it says, a dog owner with a household income below the federal poverty level for an unaltered animal, it's $27 per dog. Okay, if it's altered, it's 8, but they can only have 4. Why can a family that's whatever, below the poverty level, apparently have as many animals as they want? How could they possibly afford them
alone? Do you want someone under the poverty level to have more than 4 dogs?
No, what I'm saying is this says that it's $27 per dog. It doesn't say that they can have one dog or a million dogs. Mm. It just says dogs per dog. But the one below it says, well, they can only have 4. No.
At that discount.
Oh, after that they have to pay full fee. But still, isn't that a lot of dogs?
Well, it is.
Yes.
No, but you can't discriminate on the basis of income.
I'd like to ask Mr. James what our relationship is with the Tahoma Oil Nation, what PAC's relationship is, that they pay.
Good question. Ms. Hubbard, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, there is no agreement with the Tahoma Oil Nation. Let's see if that's the question directly. Now, we provide no services with the exception of when the rangers from the neighboring districts who have policed up pets along our border that are back and forth all the time bring us animals we feel is more responsible and appropriate and saves us time to have to go pick up loose dogs in those areas. They've already picked them up and bring them to us, so we do take those pets in from those and do not charge anything to them at this point. It's very, very nominal compared to the total number we have. Not like hundreds. Well, maybe it's hundreds, but it's not more than 200 or 300 a year that we get from them. And again, it saves the calls we're going to get from those where we have common borders, leaving the rest of Pima County has a common border, like along the San Javier District. But that's the number of animals we don't have to go out and pick up and send our enforcement to deal with it, if they comply or aggression or loose or any of those types of things. So for that benefit alone, we will, if they're pick them up and bring them in, we'll take them at this point. Is that correct, Kristen, on here? Make sure that's correct.
We're taking a few more than, or about 500. But everything else was accurate. Also, just if I can point out that there's some of the sickest animals.
There's what?
Some of the sickest animals.
Well, that's a good question. It is something that has also gone already.
I want to clarify. I agree with increasing the licensing fees. I do agree with the double fee. And if we have to take a vote on this ordinance, can we split it and take that license, the double fee out? If you want PAC approval or support, can we split this and separate out the double fee from the licensing fee increase?
I think we can.
Yeah. Okay.
You can make any more than that.
Right.
Okay.
Maybe it's a technical issue. I don't see who is charged with this new drop-off fee. It says animals surrendered from jurisdiction. It doesn't say the individual who drops it off. It doesn't say could the language say that the jurisdictions in which it was dropped shall be charged? And does it have to be surrendered? The chairman just indicated that if there was a call from Xanadu's law enforcement agency and we went and got the dog, why couldn't we, could a county ordinance charge the jurisdiction who's required, who required the pickup?
Yep.
It, this doesn't say who pays.
Mr. Chairman, that's exactly, that's an excellent point. The intent is, and the way that the ordinance is written, it can make a little confusing if you don't have the whole thing in front of you, because the first line in the ordinance says, Pima Animal Care Center may charge pound fees pursuant to the following schedule.
Yes.
The schedule is for animals surrendered from a jurisdiction that does not have a full cost recovery-based animal sheltering service agreement with Pima County, the fee is $35. The how-to and the who-to, we have that, we have a whole section all the way down to 00. The fees that we charge for the person that is the owner, if it has an owner. And in this case, this is the first time we've gone with someone that's not the owner that's responsible for the fee, because all the rest of them have owners attached. All the rest of the fees have owners attached. This is the first time we have to do that very thing. So there's a process that if the Xanadu law enforcement gets in a real bad strait and says, we need you to come and get them, well, I'll have the check in hand when we get there. We ain't coming. Maybe the response. So all that would have to be worked out. You're exactly right.
I think you need more language.
Are you against the city paying it?
I don't agree with the drop-off fee, but the licensing fee, yeah, I can and see it. We haven't raised them in a long time. However, there's a couple things on number 7 about poverty. There should be a limit on how many dogs that does apply. The other thing is, what's the percentage of people who are actually having their dogs vaccinated versus those who actually license? We used to have door-to-door license checks. I don't know how many people remember that. It might be an idea to have a group of volunteers.
There are no volunteers like that.
Train as.
We don't have enough volunteers.
They might be willing. People might be willing to. We may have some retired peace officers who are willing to go door to door and do a check. And I think the first time that they have a neighborhood or first two neighborhoods and it's out in the news that they're checking to see if your animals are vaccinated by a veterinarian and licensed, we're going to see an increase in compliance. I think if they make it very clear that this is serious, and we also need to take a look at the number one pet in the nation is not covered by licensing in this community. And I know that people who have feral communities, we could just say there is a registration fee for a feral cat population, but the cats come into this equation too, because right here, this is discriminatory against dog owners too. Because why should the dog owners have to do it and not the cat owners? That's a lot of people have the attitude. So that's something that's going to come up again and again. And I think with what we're looking at here, the other thing is Maricopa charges a heck of a lot more for taking an intake on a cat, from what I understand, than they do the dog. Because they're not covered under the licensing in the state.
I don't think that the state law requires shelters to take in cats, do they?
Ms. Hubbard, Mr. Chairman, there's no law that requires taking in stray cats.
Yeah,
there is one that talks about stray dogs.
But we could maybe we could do a local ordinance for that, and but you know it could come out to be or not take them in. For the very reason for the cost.
So, when you presented this, is that for the committee to give like a stamp of approval on it, or just to inform us about it?
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, great question. I did not make myself clear enough that the request is that the committee move a position, like what I said, back to the county staff and the board supervisors on this ordinance, and that could be a split position, it could be all yes, all no, a motion such as the committee moves to support the license fee increase provision, but does not support the surrender fee provisions in this proposed ordinance.
Okay, so what we'll do is we'll go with just the verb that you just used. All in?
Someone needs to move it.
I was just rephrasing it.
Okay.
Just rephrasing it. Okay, so you rephrase it, and then we'll see if someone makes that motion. Okay? See?
I do not want to put the words in the committee's mouth.
No, you're not. We're just
saying. As I took a straw poll of the discussion, it appears the committee would support, let me start with the beginning of it. The committee does not support, the committee would recommend to the county staff and the board of supervisors that it not pursue a surrender fee for the Pima Animal Care Center, but the $1 license per year for 5 year dog license fee increase is supported by the committee.
And that we double the budget for PAC. If we can do it.
2% increase.
2% increase.
And again,
well, 2% is not enough. Ms. Mendelson, are you going to make that motion? Or?
No. Well, I will.
Okay,
all right.
All right, so this is where we're going.
No, we have have to have a second.
We have a second.
I'm sorry.
We have a second. All right, on that. So the motion's on the floor as we heard it. It has a second. Now we're in discussion. Dr. Snow.
I would like to amend number 7 to match number 8 so that it's still limits the dogs to 4 if we're going to give them a discount, because this says there is no discount on 7. Basically, it says that right now they can license as many dogs as they want for 27 without having to pay an additional fee if they have more than 4. But if they pay 8, after 4, they have to pay the full fee, I assume. Read number 7 and number 8 together.
Ms. Melson, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, when that was first presented, the purpose of that fee is to provide low-income families an opportunity and a motivation if they have pets to get them altered, so they go from a $27 a year fee to $8. For anybody that has any low-income family that has pets, if they don't get them altered after the first year, they're going to be paying $27, period. And the real thing that may be a legal issue is we can't be discriminatory and require limit the number of pets that low-income family has versus everyone else.
I'm not saying that.
That's exactly what that ordinance would say.
No, what it says is the same thing what number 8 says, which is that they pay $8 a limit of 4 dogs. Number 7 has no limit at all.
Are you saying limit?
Number 7 and number 8.
The low license, so you
see it?
Yeah, so what you would say is that
it's $27 up to 4 dogs.
Let me ask a question. Dogs. If they have more than 4 dogs, what do they do? They're not allowed to license them?
They have to pay under number 8, which is obviously more than they don't.
Wait a second, I want to say something. But if you are charging them $27 for one per dog, but one altered dog, and let them pay $60 for more,
that's what I'm saying.
So that they don't.
After 4.
No, 4.
After one.
Because we don't want people to have unaltered dogs.
Correct.
Yeah, I don't.
I wouldn't give anybody a discount for an unaltered dog.
So just for per, it says per it, dog.
I think we should try to dissuade people from having unaltered dogs, whether they are low income or whatever income they have.
I second that.
Okay, wait a minute. It says per dog.
Right.
But I wouldn't give them a discount
not
at all. I wouldn't give anybody a discount on an unaltered dog.
Okay.
We want to dissuade people from having an unaltered dog.
So I'm making the motion to remove number 7 from this the equation.
I agree.
Add that to the motion.
Okay. Mr. James, do you have something to say? Because I'm confused on this right now.
The point is, people who have unaltered dogs have to pay more money for licensing to sort of dissuade them from having unaltered dogs.
Right.
So somebody who has a low income in their household, we really want to dissuade them from having unaltered dogs, because that person may think they're going to make money for a backyard breeder.
Yeah.
So we should not give anybody a discount for an unaltered dog, no matter what their income is. It
makes total sense. Can we split that from the original motion that we're talking
take
about?
The second motion to take 7
the
out.
Second motion on that, we're just talking about the license fee and then
okay.
The whether we agree to have a surrender fee.
Okay.
All right.
So
before it gets
motion.
So complicated.
Okay.
Yes, Ms. Huff.
I have discussion about that point.
Which point?
The one about separating them and not doing. I just want to make sure that we aren't giving the city of Tucson in particular the wrong message. Because if we say that we're going to take in all these animals, whether you pay us or not, I think that's how I see it.
No, the only thing we're doing is not supporting a surrender fee.
No, but I thought the surrender fee was for only for the districts that don't pay the county for caring for their animals. So we're telling the city, that's okay, the Pima Animal Care Advisory Committee voted, we're not going to take charging and take fees, so why would they pay us any money at all if we're not going to charge and take fees? It's just a question.
The fee goes to, fees to the individuals, to individual people who are bringing in the dogs, not to the city.
Exactly.
I don't read it that way.
I don't see
a drop-off fee. I see a fee that can be charged by the county that doesn't say to whom or how or why. It just says, if the dog is surrendered, the county can charge a fee. It doesn't say it's a drop-off fee. It doesn't say the person who shows up. It doesn't, you know, and that's why I'm not going to vote for this motion, because it's unclear. If they're saying to those non-contract jurisdiction, you know, that we believe the county can charge you a fee, and we will do it when the animal is surrendered from your jurisdiction, I'd support that. If it's a drop-off fee, I won't support it. And I can't tell from the language in front of me. Thank you.
I don't think that, I mean, I agree with you, but I don't think that this is the best strategy to try and get the city of Tucson to pay their bill. By just saying, look, we're just going to, from now on, anybody who lives in Tucson, if you have a dog that you don't want or need surrendering or you found one or something, if it comes from the city of Tucson, we'll charge those people. I don't think that's going to move the city council to say or do the things that they really need to do, which is to take care of the city of Tucson, either start their own shelter or pay the fees that they really need to pay. I just think they're going to say, go ahead, fine, charge everybody. I don't think, and it's just going to hurt the animals.
Well, I totally don't agree with that, but...
How will it not hurt the animals?
How will it, I mean, when, the animals aren't hurting now, are they?
Oh, absolutely they are. If right now, if people, you shut down that and start people that come to this door, and you start saying, I'm going to charge you this amount of money, and then they'll drop the dog off right there in the parking lot and walk away.
That's what they told the Humane Society, everybody when we went to the
But see, they're bringing them over here.
Yes.
They're bringing them here. They're not leaving them over there. As a matter of fact, people at the Humane Society tell them to bring them here.
Yes, they do.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
May I ask what you see in the proposed ordinance that the individual dropping off is charged a fee? I don't.
Okay. We'll find it.
Mr. Chair, Mr. Jacobs, if I may. We agree that the language can be cleaned up as it moves forward. We understand that the need to query is that who pays that.
Who is being charged?
Isn't that not the intent? Is that the individual will be paying it? If they say, I live in the city of Tucson, and here's a dog, they will say, give me $60.
But it needs to be in the language you are in here.
Yes.
Okay. And that can be included in the full.
Well, so the intent is to charge the drop off.
Individual.
I don't support that.
All right, so let's start this over. You need to vote.
Okay, I'm not for the fee, but I am for the intake fee, but I'm for the licensing fee.
All right, that's her vote. Can we do that?
Well, the motion is.
I tell you, we'll do it individually.
The motion, that's the motion, so if you want to just call, right,
is that,
call a question.
All right, so let's call the. All in favor?
Aye. What is the motion?
Yeah. That we will not charge an intake fee, but we will increase the license.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
We voted on her language, not surrender fee, intake fee.
Intake fee.
Whatever the language is.
It's important. You know what I mean? The language is important.
You're not supporting fees being charged individually.
Correct.
All opposed? No. Abstain? You're abstained. Okay.
Because I'm not in favor of raising the license fee.
Okay.
And those two things should have been separated, but well, we kind of did.
We did.
Now I want to make the next motion that Ms. Benson brought up about the unaltered dogs. That I don't believe anybody should get any discount for an unaltered dog, no matter what their income is, and that everybody should be charged $60 if they have an unaltered dog.
Second. You're seconding it?
No, I'm going to speak to it.
All right.
Mr. Smith motion.
And we have a second.
Pat is the second for the first second.
All right. Discussion. Discussion. Mr. Jacobs.
Deja vu all over again. In 2000, when I remember the unoffered fee was raised to something like $60, $60 or $70, the argument was made, then they'll have their dog altered. I'm willing, although I don't have the statistics in front of me, if you go back and look percentage-wise of the dogs that were altered and unaltered, that were licensed at that point in time in 2000 versus the ones that were in 2014, that percentage has not changed, and the fee has. You're arguing, you're specious. Raising the fee does not change who will have an unaltered dog, because people like me, who breed dogs for a good reason and love my unbred, my unaltered dog, and I'm willing to pay the $70 fee, are the ones who are paying. And now you're saying that our poor person down the street can't even pay less because I'm willing to pay more. It wasn't fair then, it's not fair now. Leave it as is.
Okay. Any more discussion?
I just wanted to make a comment on what you said about when the fee was lowered.
Right.
Prior to the fee being lowered, when it was $75, the Humane Society could not keep up with the spay neuter. A lot of people don't spay neuter their dogs because they're lazy. But when the money went up to $75, it was crazy. People want to spay neuter their dogs. And I understand why breeders don't want to spay neuter their dogs. I mean, and you should be willing to pay the $70. But seriously, the numbers did go down. I mean, did go up of space.
Like this, it came right back, and now I'm talking about over the period 2000.
I know what you're talking about.
2014, not the 6 months or 9 months where the people realized, yes, it's cheaper to, at that point, it was about the same cost. Now, spay and neutering is not about $75.
Dr. Sophia.
Okay. I have also bred dogs, many dogs in my life. I consider myself a breeder. Now only an occasional breeder. And I think that any dog with breeding should be, the owner of that dog should be willing to pay whatever price it takes. That's my personal opinion. If it was $150, I would pay it, okay? To keep a dog worthy of breeding. The other ones would be neutered, okay? And because not every dog is worthy of breeding for a good breeder, that isn't just out there looking to make a buck. And I also think that that keeping the fee high for people of low income for a breedable dog, will encourage them to have them spayed or neutered. So I would agree with the motion that's made.
Any further discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
5, 6, 7, 7. All opposed? 1.
Mr. Chair, just want to clarify. In essence, the committee has moved that paragraph 7 be removed. That's what the motion was.
What happened?
Okay. Should we make more money?
Yeah.
I got the motion.
Yeah, well.
I'm not very little money. That's not very little.
You won't get more money.
Jack's.
You'll leave them on the street, just like your argument about dropping
off. No, but listen, it's been 15 years, right? Inflation has gone up, so we need to take care of inflation. 15 years usually.
I'm not charging you for $1.
Okay. I'm going to move to number 8 because it's late. Well, number 8, as I have it written, is housing animals at the Ajo Animal Care Facility. And I bring that up because a little over a year ago, we had some animals that were sent over to the Ajo facility. And those animals stayed there. Although they were socialized here, a couple of them were socialized here. Take one and pack it, please. This is just my notes. And when those dogs sat there for an extended period of time, we started questioning why the animals were taken over to Ajo. And the intent was that Ajo, little dogs would get adopted in Ajo sooner. And because they didn't have enough
inventory or whatever it was called. Those dogs, and that those couple dogs there, stayed there for an extended period of time until the agreement was to bring them back. So we had a volunteer, two volunteers go up and get those dogs and brought them back to this facility. Now keeping in mind the AHO facility is open 3 days a week, 2 hours per day. Now these dogs stay there for that entire time. It's only open those 2 hours, 3 days a week. So that back then, that very same dog that was socialized here, that was picked up over there, then peed all over the volunteer as they picked it up because then it wasn't socialized anymore. So come to find out, we're sending dogs again back out to AHO from here to send them back out to AHO. For what, and so my question then is, before I have a series of more questions, why are we sending dogs to AHO, Arizona?
Good question.
Diverted.
Sorry, we'll leave that question in your chat.
Mr. Chairman, this committee, I'm going to have Justin speak to the specific dogs. I know that since this was brought up, there's been a lot of conversation about it. And you know, Dr. Garcia and I were talking about how do we balance providing service there, because we would have a lot to answer to if we pulled adoption from there at all. So how would we, you know, maybe using technology or something, provide that service to the folks in AHO? And so we don't really have the technology to do that now, but those are some of the ideas that have been on the table so that we can satisfy the need to serve the community there that we're responsible for, but not have these types of situations.
And that makes sense, because I talked with him as well, and we're talking about being able to service the individuals in AHO. But right now, we're not really servicing the individuals in AHO, and this is assuming some of this is correct, because when you look on Pat Harbor, that thing isn't up to date. It doesn't really give you an accurate number of the dogs that are there. But you had Mike, for example, that was there, and he was a wheat and terrier mix that would have probably been adopted out here in a week or so. He was there since July 11th. And he's no longer listed now. But I mean, he was there all that time in AHO. And then we go down this list. I can just repeat myself over and over and over with each one of these dogs. So the question then, again, is they get dogs over there. They may not get little dogs, but they get dogs over there. But these little dogs that we sent over there aren't getting adopted. One got adopted finally, this one here. Mike got adopted there, but it took July, November, December, January. That's a long time for a dog to have to sit in a facility that is open only 3 days a week, 2 hours a day.
Mike wasn't a transfer from here. Mike was actually brought into the AHO facility.
Okay, so even carrying that thought forward,
yeah.
Should the dog sit there for 6 to 8 weeks?
I think that is the discussion. They do on a, I would say, bi-monthly basis, bring us a portion of their dogs. I think that they're trying to, in discussions with Debbie Moreau, the officer there, they're trying to keep a variety of pets in their shelter for their community, which is in the two times that we've actually sent small dogs up there. All of them have been adopted. Of the recent, we sent two others out there. One was adopted within a week and a half, and then Phoebe sat there for quite some time and was adopted, I believe, on March 2nd.
There was a terrier named Phoebe who was transferred on November 6th, and she was just adopted now in March.
Yes.
So, yeah, it wasn't like they were just adopted.
No, but the other dog that was sent up there, the other smaller dog that was transferred with Phoebe that day was adopted, I wouldn't say immediately, but
was Smokey, which was a Chi, was sent there on January 9th, and was transferred just back to PAC now on March 11th. We can assume it was, we asked for the names, but we just were told it
was transferred from here?
Transferred here, finally, back to us. Was kept there, small dog, Smokey, is it she, right?
Yeah, I just, I my question is, was that a dog that was transferred from this location to Ajo? Well, or a dog that I believe it was brought in, that was another one that was brought in directly to the Ajo and then transferred here.
Well, see, but that would be my question. How do I know whether you're, what dogs you're sending up there?
You're aware of everything that you sent. The last ones we sent were Phoebe and the other.
That's it?
Well, we've sent four small dogs since.
Okay, so if a little dog can sit up there, let's say a dog comes in over there, Smokey. So you have, is Jenny your favorite one? So we know small dogs over here go like that, and that's the majority of them that we can adopt out really quick. Why would we leave a little dog over there for 3-4 months? Just because Debbie thinks that.
At the time when we transferred him, in both cases.
I mean, this dog came from there, you're saying, Cheek.
Yeah, I'm seeing in the Baxter and Chica, which is the situation that if the initial transfer that brought it up on to the advisory committee the first time this topic was brought up, and then the most recent one was in November. Those are the times that we'd actually transfer dogs that way. Since then, the majority of the transfers are the opposite. When they come up for their weekly spay-neuter runs, they're bringing us the overflow. They're a portion have 8 kennels, and so when their population comes up, they're transferring dogs to us. I think what can be done from here, because we don't disagree. I think what can be done is coming up with some sort of timeline plan that I'd be happy to talk with Debbie and come up with, that if a pet, regardless of, if a pet is sitting in their care for a month, that it's transferred up here. That, or, you know, come up with some timeline so that we don't have dogs that are sitting with limited exposure for 3 months. I agree with what Kristen said as well, increasing some technology, because going out, visiting that facility, I have concerns about our funding at times here and ability to do things. They're almost in a rotary phone stage, so they are. It's a very challenging. It's a challenge facility.
Well, and I'll just a minute though. But how do they get vet care as well? I mean, every dog that came from there was transferred back from over there. Immediately went into the vet's office in there. Was something wrong with all those dogs?
No, we automatically 4DX test everything that comes. Ajo is in an area that at the center we've determined, just similar to parts of South Tucson and the reservation, there's a higher risk for tick-borne illnesses. And so what we automatically put them on the to-do list for those checks to get 4DX tested.
And how often does vet go out to Ajo and check those dogs?
To my knowledge, you don't send a vet out there.
Well, or a vet,
they're bringing.
How often do they bring in a vet?
They bring pets to us weekly.
So a dog can be out there and need medical care and isn't going to get medical care out there?
Debbie has, the officer there has relationships with, personally has relationships with veterinarians for emergent situations. But
she personally has? What's that mean?
She has friends and a vet that's in, that lives
but
there.
But there's
nothing
that
it's not something that
the Pima County has entered into.
No.
How does she pay for that then?
They've actually been taking, it's been pro bono veterinary.
Okay, so the county, so we can assume that, you know, there could be dogs that aren't the same vet care they get here.
Oh, yes.
Doctor?
Now, we're doing this so that we can get small dogs to that community so people who want small dogs can adopt them.
Yes, the 2 transfers that we're talking about, yes.
Well, rather than send dogs to sit there for 2 or 3 or 4 months in a crate and not get the socialization, if we really think that people who live in that community want small dogs, why don't we periodically have, you know, a fair like we have here and take a bunch of small dogs down there and see if they get adopted that day, rather than let them sit it down there.
That's
and maybe
idea.
Get tick fever or whatever they're going to catch down there.
That's a very good idea.
See? Okay.
Plus, there's lots of, there's that, there's the kiosk that, you know, people that live in Ajo, obviously they must use, they must buy things online because Ajo isn't necessarily metropolis, right? So they're used to looking and finding things on the computer. why couldn't we do something like that? You get your dog, you find the right dog like people do here on the computer, and if you want that dog, and you know, then we do the paperwork and all that stuff like they're supposed to. You know, they get vetted and all that. Then we'll send the dog for them to see, but not, you know, like just have the dog sit there.
I think part of the challenge that we've run into is that we've been very focused on this facility, which is the heavy majority of them. We've done a lot of increases. They're a length away. They're still part of that, but they're such a distance away that they are getting the minimal attention. And we've relied on Debbie for years to kind of run her, run that facility and maintain the dogs there, the numbers there, when they creep up, do that run up here to surrender. And like I said, the drop off had been on a weekly basis.
Because I heard that we don't get a vehicle but once a month back from over there. That's what I was told.
We're getting them weekly.
Weekly?
Yeah. Weekly or bi-weekly if they have a slow week. But we've been taking them in, and they do runs up here for spaying and dirt. Which would be, depending on the numbers, Wednesday.
I'm just wondering, in a facility that's only open 6 hours a week, how often are these animals being checked on and
they have adoption hours for 6 hours a week. There's a full-time officer and two part-time officers there that are in the facility, as well as a handful of volunteers. They do have one lonely volunteer that comes in to get each dog out on a daily basis.
So they do have human contact.
Yeah, but again, it's if we're going to, it's not to with our volunteer manpower here, our open hours, it is less than we have here.
You have two full time officers over there?
We have one full time and two part time.
Two part time.
Mr. Chair. Certain number of things.
We have one full time equivalent. We have two part time and one occasional. We do not have two full-time officers in a hall. We have three employees in a hall to get paid equivalent to one full-time salary. So,
is that still okay?
So just to clarify that one. But they do, there is an employee required every day to go in there and clean, feed, water, make sure they're okay, and then volunteer to assist with the social thing.
I will be checking any answers.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
No.
All right. Well, I'm concerned still about us sending dogs over there. And I believe that Ajo should be a transfer station to us. Just like the males going to Phoenix. And it isn't coming back. And they can process it and they can get it done because they have the facilities to do it. We're actually better at getting dogs out, taking care of them, doing all of that, but then encouraging the adoptions so that they have actually better, they're getting treated, the individuals that live out there would get better service from us.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, all of you. I don't know that I would ever feel comfortable saying we will never transfer pet to Ajo, but I agree that that shouldn't really be at all the norm. And I think, like Justin said, we should have a protocol in place if that comes up again to ensure that pet is coming back in a short period of time. And then I really like Dr. Smith's idea of having adoption events in Ajo, so we're still serving that community, but not having them on a regular basis. So I think we have some pretty solid action items.
Yeah, because this rope for a dog in the back of that little truck, you know, going all the way up, especially in the summer, in the hot, going all the way up there and then back and stuff like that. They don't know where they're going, and that's all they're doing is sitting in that steel little compartment. Anyway. That was what I had to say on that. Moving on to...
Mr. Chair, I hate to interrupt, and I know it's been a long night, and I deeply appreciate all the work, but you did pass the ordinance to amend the advisory committee to provide a seat for Ms. Barrett, you know, she's not here because Barrett emerged, and for them to, and they've asked to replace her, or to place her on the committee again once that provision is made, plus the issue of removing the Arizona, potentially Arizona from the position from the committee is part of that ordinance.
I believe we voted to do that, the first, I mean, we voted already to take them out of this committee.
Correct, but replacing Fair with PPFL is the additional change.
Okay, do we have a motion to do that?
I'll make that motion that we replace Fair with PPFL.
Second? Okay, discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
I didn't oppose.
No, I know, I saw that today.
So, thank you. Thank you, Mark.
You have the semi-annual report in front of you, I mean, I sent that out to you. That, and along with the letter that you all, that I've written about us getting together about the Tucson, Arizona, you know, situation, rather than me just send that out to the volunteers and stuff, I was wondering if you all were interested in, so there would be signatures for all of us. It would go to the volunteers, it would go to the community as a whole, saying that we support, you know, you read that part about PAC doing what we're doing now, essentially incorporating everything in this Barney that we talked about. And so that, because that's going to eventually start getting the movement now within the community to, we'll be on TV, it'll be on radio, it'll be on the news, and things like that. So the committee as a whole, rather than just me saying that, I think we, because we all agree to it.
Would you represent the committee?
Well, that can be me. I mean, I just wanted to get your opinion. If you want me to do it, or you want the committee to do it.
I think it's better to have one spokesman.
Yeah, okay. Just representing the committee.
Okay. All right.
I was going to say it looks better if we all sign it, but I'll go along with the majority.
Okay. I just wanted to get your opinion. Okay. And we will... You still had something on the agenda item, Humane Society.
We can put that on.
At the next one? All right. All right. Total of 1,271 individuals gave $25,000 in change in donations during the month of February. There were two complaints and no commendations received by staff during February. We have the last call to the audience. You guys are sick of us. Any announcements?
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I just want to remind you that there was the Adopt Love, Adopt Local event hosted by the event Alliance Animal Pima.
Alliance.
Welcome. So many alliances last year. I think you can straight that will be on April 11th, starting at 9 to 5, I believe, 9 to 4 on that day, and there was an email required that I sent out and a copy shipped to Ms. Green. So just want to remind you that it's a big event. All of our rescues, all of our partners, a lot of welfare, some training, some demonstrations. It's going to be quite a day. So just encourage you to consider sharing as much as possible that information so those as I can would join.
And if you don't volunteer, we need them because we're short on adoptions and things like that.
I have an announcement just to let everybody know. I put it up on Facebook and stuff, but the Humane Society, starting next Tuesday, is going to be commencing a rattlesnake avoidance training. And we're already seeing rattlesnake bites. Well, you can go online. It starts the 24th of March, but it's going to go through to October. We're going to do it all summer.
Okay. The next meeting is April 16, 2015. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
Oh, I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.